Nintendo! They're pretty big, right? And they've made a ton of games, all proudly published by Nintendo. Because when you're that big, why wouldn't you publish your own games? Well, as it turns out, that has happened. And we're not talking back in the 70s or when they made ports for other systems like Mario Brothers for Atari 2600. We are talking when they were already huge. 1995, a big year. The year of Donkey Kong Country 2, Chrono Trigger, the PlayStation, and John Cartwright. Nintendo were gearing up for the N64 and were known globally as the faces of video games, only rivaled by Sega and now the PlayStation. Mario was big, Zelda was big, Donkey Kong and Star Fox and Metroid were all big. Whether it was at home or on the go, Nintendo were known as one of the biggest brands in the entire world. And that makes this very, very curious. Snoopy Concert, released in 1995 exclusively for the Super Famicom in Japan. Published by Mitsui Fudosan and Dentsu Incorporated, and merely licensed by Nintendo, just like any other third-party game on the system. This is a cute little Peanuts game designed around the Super Nintendo mouse, and the format is pretty similar to Kirby Superstar. Basically, Snoopy's holding a concert, and you've got to get every member of the Peanuts gang there one by one by doing little sub-games. But Snoopy's got some big reveals at his concert, like the credits. Now, it never officially says developed by Nintendo, but the names? They're a big deal. Directed by Ishin Shimizu. Hey, editing John? Pull up the credits for F-Zero. Oh. So this guy, who also goes by Kazunobu Shimizu, is a fairly prominent name. He isn't just in the credits for F-Zero. He directed F-Zero. He directed F-Zero and Snoopy Concert. You'll also know him as a designer on Zelda 2, where he made his debut. But it's not just one Nintendo employee! No! Tomoyuki Sumi? Pokemon Snap? Aiko Takahashi? F-Zero GX? Oh, and sound by Hirokazu Tanaka! Okay, that is huge. Let me just play a few of the tracks this guy's responsible for. So yeah, that's pretty big, right? But Tanaka is now the president of Creatures. Yeah, the guys who own the Pokemon Company, alongside Nintendo and Game Freak. He worked on a Snoopy game. There's actually even more legacy musical talent in here. Manako Hamano co-composed games like Super Metroid and Link's Awakening. She's even still involved in Metroid music with games like Dread. And in the special thanks, Kazumi Totaka? As in this Kazumi Totaka, the Totaka's song guy. Good lord. And as it turns out, all these credits belong to two different studios. One is Paxophonica, a support studio that pretty much only made Nintendo games. They helped with Balloon Kid, Wave Race, Pokemon Snap, Hamtaro. And the other studio is Nintendo R&D 1. Yeah, Nintendo's oldest development house, who made all of these classic games and were responsible for the Game Boy. They made Snoopy Concert. What are you? It's so odd. Nintendo pretty much always publishes their licensed games. Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3 was published by them. Even going back way further, the Mickey Mouse Game & Watch was a fully developed and Nintendo published product. And you know what? So was the Game & Watch Snoopy Tennis, another Snoopy game. And this is even documented in Brawl. Snoopy Concert is nowhere to be seen. There's for sure been cases where they haven't published works that use their IP, like Hotel Mario and Mario's Time Machine, but those were all developed by third parties. And were really bad. They made this! I'm sure there's some other example like Snoopy Concert, but I can't think of any. It's fascinating that Tanaka was the primary composer, as he also worked on the Mother series, something that's heavily inspired by Peanuts. Obviously it makes sense for there to be some parallels, but so many moments in Snoopy Concert gave me massive Mother 2 vibes. Like, I can't explain this, but this is an earthbound cave, okay? And again, the music! A lot of it's just variations on the Peanuts theme, but again, it's done in such a similar sounding way to Earthbound. So alright, Nintendo made this, but what the heck is it? Well, I'll let this commercial do the talking. Well, now you know. You can play with a standard Super Nintendo controller if you want to, but don't, because this game needs surprisingly fast reflexes for a kid's game. Everyone dig out their Super Nintendo mouse with their plastic mouse pad. I always liked to roll the balls on these things as a kid. Old mice are two toys for the price of one. Almost every game shares a control scheme. Moving the mouse around controls Woodstock, and we can guide Snoopy just by clicking where to go. If you click above him, he'll jump, and if you click below him, he'll crawl. Pretty simple. Alright, so who are we starting with? We can do any sub-game in any order we want. Man, the freedom. Left to right, then? Come on, rerun! Oh, this is nothing like what I just explained. Fun! For whatever reason, Rerun is the only character to have a game with completely different mechanics, but that's okay. Let's just find our bearings and figure out what's going on. Oh, he found a balloon! Rerun, no! Alright, so what do we do? Oh, clicking the chair slows it down, okay. So we can control the speed. Hey, Snoopy. Snoopy, no! I thought you wanted us at your concert. Why would you abduct Rerun? Okay, so you can't touch balloons, and you can't go too slow or Snoopy just steals you. Ah, we can pop the balloons! This makes way more sense. Watch out for gates, I guess. Alright, pop the balloons, don't go too slow or Snoopy will steal you, but stay somewhat fast so you can react to the gates. I have got this! I don't got this. Alright, eventually I figured it out and got to a checkpoint in this grocery store section where... Ow! Oh, we're doing the whole thing again, huh? Even with a mouse in the grocery store section, I'm just clicking near where she throws the fruit. Just constantly clicking usually gets them. Most have a slow falling curve and they're fine, but these apples? They're way too fast and you can't even see what she's gonna throw until she's thrown it. There's no reaction time. Okay, eventually I did this too, and the game is still going. The parking lot section isn't too bad. These balls roll straight back after clicking them, so you've gotta go rather fast. But otherwise, pretty standard one, and I appreciate that. We're still going. No pressure, if we die here, we just do everything again. Oh my god. What do you mean speed up? We haven't been taught to speed up. How do I speed up? Oh, so I figured out you speed up by clicking the back of the chair, but it never tells you that. You've never had to speed up until now. And it doesn't tell you to slow down again, so this happened. Would have been nice to know. But oh boy, eventually I got Rerun to the theater. Not only is this a kid's game, but some probably weren't using a mouse. Someone check on the kids who grew up with this game, they can't be okay. But the rest of the game is nothing like this though, so let's try Linus. I'm playing a fan translation by the way, so I don't miss out on any important Peanuts lore. So Linus wants to give Lydia a flower, but she won't tell him where she lives, which is fine, back off Linus! But instead, he sends Snoopy as Joe Call. Joe Call's one of Snoopy's alter egos, which first appeared in the Peanuts comic strip from May 27th, 1971. As Joe Call, Snoopy pretends to be a college student. To become Joe Call, the Beagle simply puts on a pair of sunglasses, leans against a wall, and says his name is Joe Call. We then race someone to giving Lydia a flower. But, little critique, I don't think an unforgiving race is the best way to learn the controls. There's no rubber banding or handicap. If you've fallen behind, you just do better next time. Your competitor sometimes shows you things like how you can't hold items while crawling, so you've got to drop them and then push them through the gap and pick them back up again. And that's a pretty cool way of showing something, but we're racing against this person, they're ahead now! Also, I didn't notice the flower thing the first time and I got to the goal without the flower. What a fool I am. Now, something began to make a bit more sense with the second stage. This is more about platforming, you just gotta beat a balloon to the top. Everything else was fine, just click above Snoopy and make him jump. But I had no idea how to get past this. This edge is just too tall. What do I do? Eventually, I worked out by accident that double clicking makes Snoopy run. And when you jump out of a run, you go even higher than a normal jump. This is not even slightly hinted at in Linus's game. There is actually a tutorial for this in Schroeder's game. The third character. Why? Here, the game takes full control and teaches you everything about the controls. How to move Snoopy, how to jump, how to run and jump. Why didn't they just swap these two around? Did they expect everyone to go, yep, let's start in the middle, the natural starting point? Anyway, made it to the top, raced the shark, got these guys to the concert. And if we ignore the points where I didn't get how any of this worked, I actually quite like this one. By the final stage, everything felt natural, and it's pretty fun and responsive. You get a gold star, Linus. Now let's go to Peppermint Patty! I can go out of order too, game! Oh, they're already at the concert. All you get is passive-aggressive dialogue. Fine, we'll go in order. Thanks for the tutorial. So this one plays just like Linus, but without any of the urgency. There's nothing to race against. It's more of just a small-scale point-and-click adventure. Snoopy can't go through this wall? Well, go back, pick up a shovel, and start digging. Can't get past this flower? Well, go back, put on the boxing gloves, and just beat it up! It's really cute. Tons of cozy, unique little animations for Snoopy, with even some costume changes. And the levels are all really small, so there's never that moment of just click on everything until you find the solution. Snoopy gets the world record for long jump, shoots himself out of a cannon, even crawls under gunfire. I said crawl, Snoopy. Hell, Snoopy even gets dynamite and uncovers a rocket, and then he steals it and flies it to the moon. Look at his little helmet. Even Woodstock has a helmet. I like this little bit here where you choose an elevator floor, and Snoopy's arm just goes impossibly far. This is Snoopy now. This is permanent. I was really enjoying this one, but then right at the end, is a 15-block slide puzzle. I struggle with the one in Resident Evil 4, and that's only 8 pieces. And you've got to do 2 of them! And you've got to read this book and memorize the phrase at the bottom to input when you finish the puzzle. And they're randomized, so I couldn't just cheat by copying the actions of someone on YouTube. And even if you back out, it doesn't reset your work. So if you've mixed them up horribly, it just says, "Fix it then, coward!" This is literally right at the end too. After this, you fly around space, pick up a flower, deliver it, the end. Go to the concert, Schroeder. Wait, Schroeder didn't do anything. And the final one, yeah, we're there already, is Charlie Brown. Charlie's baseball equipment's gone missing, and so Detective Snoopy roams freely around town, looking for clues to find the culprit. It's actually really similar to the last one, only instead of small linear levels, you've got a giant sandbox to explore. You can visit the individual homes of the Peanuts gang, take a bus to school, take another bus downtown, or take another bus to camp. I couldn't keep track of these buses. Usually I'd go, yep. Nope. There's a lot of that in here. Oh look, 3 different buildings. What's in this one? Nothing. What about this one? Hi. What about this classroom? Oh look, it's nothing. What about this one? Hi. I can see just a free-roaming Peanuts game being a cool idea though. I used to love Virtual Springfield as a kid, which was kinda similar. You just explored Springfield and saw the characters and interacted with the gags. That was really neat. But this is the more tedious style of point and click. It's one big trade sequence, and figuring out where to go next is often a complete guess. Like, to start off, it isn't too bad. Sally drops her lunchbox on the way to school, so you pick it up, take the bus to school, find out what classroom she's in, talk to her, and she'll trade you the lunchbox for a theater ticket. Cool, this probably goes to the theater. Here you find Franklin, who gives you some popcorn. What do you want me to do with this? Obviously, you're meant to bring the popcorn to the person on the school grounds, and when you talked to them earlier, they made no references to popcorn, so this is the obvious solution. You then get a wig, who you give to a bird in a tree. There's like 40 more minutes of this. Long story short, some of these items are Charlie's baseball equipment, and he gets them all back in the end. I'm very sorry to spoil that for you. And with that, everyone can go to the concert. Roll credits. Wait, Ishin Shimizu directed this? That was Snoopy Concert. It had its ups and downs, tedious moments, and legitimately fun and endearing moments. But regardless of the quality, in the end, the pedigree behind it is just fascinating. This came from the director of F-Zero and the composer of so many Nintendo classics. While it most likely didn't have the same time and resources as other Nintendo games, it's still an important footnote in their history. The time Nintendo made a Snoopy game, and didn't let the world know. So I definitely wouldn't call this game a masterpiece by any means, but it's just such an oddity. It's fascinating. A Nintendo-developed first-party game that doesn't say it was done by Nintendo and wasn't published by Nintendo. I think this is something a lot of Nintendo collectors and fans and just historians should give a go, because it's wild. But as it turns out, Nintendo didn't stop doing Snoopy concerts, because follow me to Animal Crossing! There he is! Play us a concert, Snoopy. You